Functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRIs, allow researchers to peer into the brains of living people while they're conscious. A window into the black box in our skulls, if you will. That's led to fascinating insights, not just about what parts of the brain are doing, but apparently even something about what the subject is thinking. And now, as in other fields, artificial intelligence may supercharge that work. So, can the AIs read our minds? Let's ask. In Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Marcel Just. He is the D.O. Hebb Professor of Psychology at Carnegie Mellon University, and we are delighted to welcome you to our program tonight, Professor Just. Let me just start by saying this month, researchers at the University of Texas used an earlier version of ChatGPT to translate the private thoughts of human subjects by analyzing brain scans. Now, you've been at this for more than a decade. What sort of initial reaction did you get when you told people about your interest in decoding thoughts just by looking at brain activity?
Well, some of our initial grant proposals came back treating us like crackpots. Like, how could you? This can't happen.
Have you ever gone back to them and said, I told you so?
I would have to graciously say that that agency is funding my work now in studying how this kind of work can facilitate the learning of scientific concepts.
Well, take us through it. How do you actually do what you do?
Well, as you say, you put someone in a scanner, and through the magic of fMRI, so this is magnetic resonance, the magnetic fields in your brain are changing, and you can measure it every second or so. And the patterns are systematic. When you're thinking about a hammer, by golly, there's a pattern there that occurs every time you think of hammer. It occurs every time anyone else thinks of hammer. When somebody, you know, whether they're in South America or Africa or Asia or whatever, if they think of hammer, that pattern occurs. I'm now speaking about the universality of this way the brain represents thought. The other very interesting thing about it is the systematicity of it. It's not just an arbitrary pattern for hammer that, you know, that occurs in everybody's brain. It's systematic. Part of the pattern consists, of course, of what the hammer looks like. Maybe that's not surprising. Another part of the pattern consists of how you hold it, you know, with your dominant hand. So when I think, or anybody thinks about a hammer, they think about their dominant hand grasping the handle of the hammer and perhaps wielding it. So these patterns are universal, they're systematic, they're decomposable. As I said, we started with concrete objects, seems like the easiest, the lowest hanging fruit, but we're now, and the field is now, looking at more and more complex forms of thought.
Well, let's pick up on that. Yes, a hammer is an object, but what about something sort of more next generation, like emotions? Can you pick that up as well?
Yes. Again, what we did is we asked our participants to go in the scanner and we say, make yourself feel angry. Imagine a very anger-inducing situation. And, you know, something happens in their brain. Well, what happens in their brain is the same thing that what happens in your brain or the brain of somebody in South America or Africa or Asia. When two people are in an intense verbal argument, ironically, the brain activity in both their heads is similar. And let me tell you some of the components that you can tell. I can't, you know, this isn't necessarily what they're angry about, but there's a very high intensity. So we know, we can decode that they're intense about their emotion. We can also decode that it's negative. It's different from happiness. You can be intensely happy or intensely angry, and they're different by virtue of their valence, positive or negative. And so another thing that happens when you're angry is another thing that happens with your anger is that your brain signals that there's another person involved. When you're sad, you can be sad all by yourself, but with anger, there's another person involved, and that social part of your brain activates and signals the presence of another person you're interacting with.
Let's fast forward to this month, because researchers using AI were apparently able to read the minds of people listening to a podcast or even watching a silent film. We're going to read a little example here. This is the original transcript of audio that the subjects were listening to. The original transcript says, "I got up from the air mattress and pressed my face against the glass of the bedroom window, expecting to see eyes staring back at me, but instead only finding darkness." And here's the one from decoded from Brain Activity. "I just continued to walk up to the window and open the glass. I stood on my toes and peered out. I didn't see anything and looked up again and I saw nothing." Now, they were also able to translate text from imagined thoughts, not just things that they were hearing. How could they do this?
Well, you see, it's kind of impressive, but imperfect. And what they did was they used this version of GPT to learn how to match brain activity to words. That was, a clever use of this. And so they're using these new AI programs as a scientific tool, essentially. It's not GPT that's doing the brain interpretation. It's a fantastic ability to map the brain patterns to words and then to help put the words together into sort of coherent text. I think, you know, there's a lot of discussion, including on your program, of the impact of programs like ChatGPT. And what I haven't heard a lot about was how it will impact science. Science is a lot about learning about patterns. And I think these programs may prove to be extremely helpful in detecting regularities, developing mappings, and interpreting all sorts of phenomena in addition to the brain activity associated with thought.
Well, take us down that road. What do you see as the sort of real life applications for what you're working on down the road?
There are two main applications for this kind of research. And, you know, you're right to ask this, because why should society support research unless there's some payoff expected? And one is in the understanding, I think, of brain dysfunction and psychiatric illnesses, so that if you can see a systematic alteration of thought and identify it and say, oh, this is such and such brain pathology, and we recognize it, and maybe we can develop a treatment for it. So it wouldn't be just behavioral symptoms that would characterize a neurological or psychiatric dysfunction, but the brain activity patterns. So that's one possible large aid in diagnosis and characterization of neurological and psychiatric disorders. And the other possible application is in education and instruction. As I said, our knowledge is systematic. Our brain has a particular kind of indexing system, a way to organize its knowledge, and it organizes the same way for everyone. And if you know the brain's organization, if you know its filing system, how it decomposes things, how it files things, then you can design your instruction to match that. If we know the brain's filing system, and as I said, we all have the same filing cabinet mentally, we can design instruction so that the information fits very naturally into that filing cabinet. Let me say something that I'm not sure is an application, but I think at the end of the day, we all want to understand ourselves. We want to know what we're about. What am I good at? What do I like? What do I represent? What are my goals? And I think that that representation of oneself will become available in a much more explicit way than it ever has been in the past. I think this is a little bit of a moonshot kind of thing, question, but still, I think it's interesting and I think it'll happen.
Let me ask you one last thing, and that is, we're asking a lot of questions these days about the ethics around artificial intelligence. You know, of course, Jeffrey Hinton has come out recently with a very significant statement about how deeply concerned he is. Do you have any ethical concerns about where all this is going?
I think that there are ethical concerns. You know, that our minds are our most private parts of ourselves. And you don't want to make those thoughts public involuntarily, certainly. And now with the current technology, there's no problem. But I could foresee a time, as Jeff Hinton did with respect to other issues, I could foresee a time where it might be possible to read people's thoughts without their consent. And I think we should strongly guard against that. I don't think it'll be with fMRI. I don't think the worry is in 5 years or 10 years. But down the road, you know, thought is ultimately electromagnetic energy occurring in this world. And if it's occurring, some biomedical engineer or someone will find out a way to measure it remotely. And then it'll be sort of public. You know, right now, you know that some of the scanning machines in airports can see your body and can reveal your body. And we kind of live with that. Well, I think that there'll be the potential to reveal your thoughts physically, you know, technologically. And as Jeff Hinton talks about guarding against the possible abuses of artificial intelligence, I think the possibility of invasion of one's thoughts is something to be strongly guarded against.
You've given us a lot to think about. Marcel Just, thank you for joining us from Carnegie Mellon University. Appreciate your time tonight here on TVO.
My pleasure.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.